श्रीकृष्णा 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 गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुसाक्षात्परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः आफ्टर स्टडिंग अपरोक्षानुभूति टू थिंग्स विल सर्टेनली हैपन टू अ सिंसियर स्टूडेंट वन थिंग इज दैट वी हैव टू गेट रिड ऑफ बॉडी आइडेंटिफिकेशन एंड द सेकेंड थिंग इज वी हैव टू डिस्कार्ड द नोशन दैट देर इज वन सोल पर बॉडी Only these two things are done, whatever we may do under the label of spirituality, religion, yoga, charity, being good social service, it is all like pouring waters on a pot which is upside down. All waste. These are the only two things. First, disidentification from the body. Second, giving up the notion that embodied is one per body. No, the one is expressing through all the bodies. There is not one electricity behind every bulb. There is only one electricity which is expressing through all the bulbs. Therefore, the meditation with this understanding will have a different dimension. It won't be a dumb kind of meditation. We simply sit down and wait when it is over. See? I was once, you know, I went with Jill to some place and it was an international yoga conference. I was invited also. We went there. And then the yogi there, calling himself Jagat Guru Yoga Acharya, something like that. And in a hot, terrible sun, where the stones will melt, we were taken to a place. And a rough area, no proper sitting place. And he said, now sit down everybody, scorching sun. And I will ring the bell, like we have got a big bell for calling you for the lunch, dinner, a small baby bell. He took out from his pocket. He said, I'll ring the bell, start your meditation. Then, again I ring the bell, stop your meditation. So all people were sitting here and there. I sat below a tree on a parapet wall. Sat means I was watching, because I didn't know what meditation is. And then he took out the bell, dun, 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 everybody sitting there. Now what will be the meditation? We have to sit like this till the next bell goes. So attention will be when the next bell goes. It is so long, why the bell is not going? Is he sleeping or what? Come on, it is too hot, man. I can't sit long. And there is no proper seat also. Stones, like, you know, being roasted in a hot air oven. From below it is hot, from top it is hot. Even there is no perspiration. By the time the perspiration comes, it is evaporated. This is meditation. Because everybody was waiting when the next bell goes. And the moment next bell went, aha, meditation over. These are the cartoons of meditation. See, friends, clarity must be there in whatever we do. There is no clarity, we are just wasting our time. Therefore, first proper knowledge, then application of that knowledge in our life. Without perfect knowledge of anatomy, Nobody can be a good surgeon. See? If somebody doesn't know anatomy properly and he has to do the surgery and he has to work on the kidney. So everything is, then he will ask the nurse, hey, excuse me, where is the kidney? Will he be able to perform the operation properly? In the same manner, visit for meditation. Support here, support there, all kinds of things around so that we can sleep properly. See? You must have seen many students when they sit for meditation, it is sitting like this after some time. See? What is that? Jhatka meditation. You know, there is halal. Opposite of halal is jhatka, jhatka meditation. That is not. So, the goal is freedom from body identification. This is done through yoga. And freedom from the notion that there is one soul per body. This is achieved through contemplation and study of Vedanta. These are the two things. So, the first step has to be taken that we have to attain freedom from body identification. Yesterday we did it through the asana. Today we'll try to achieve the same thing through pranayama. Pranayama is meant only for achieving freedom from body identification. Now let us get the idea about our personality. You must have done it sometime in your life. These days, because of the email, the snail mail has become outdated. But in the earlier days, there used to be a snail mail. So we take the stamp, put it on our tongue, make it wait, and then fix it on the envelope. And then send it to the post. Sometime it happens. It happened with me, therefore I am giving this example. So I fixed the stamp on the envelope and then left the envelope. And when I wanted to give it for posting, I said, let me check. And then I found it was a wrong envelope on which I have fixed the ticket of 25 rupees. Say, my God, now it will be torn. What could be done? So I did meditation. What was the meditation? Took out the content from the envelope and put the envelope in the water, samadhi in the water. When it was put in the waters, the glue fixing the stamp and the envelope together was slowly dissolved and then I could peel off that stamp and can be reused. No destruction. If this is clear, in the same manner, the body and the mind, they are glued together by the glue of prana or the breathing. When the breathing stops, mind and the body are separated. See. Now this separation can be achieved, as I told you, under three conditions. One is under deep sleep, ignorance. That time we are not identified with the body, although the body is alive. In under compulsion, when there is a death, when the body is completely separated from the mind and the body falls dead. See? Now the third condition is what we are trying to achieve. Neither we want to sleep nor we want to die. Therefore, what should be done? The glue which is bringing the body and the mind together has to be worked upon. And that glue is our breathing. Now the second point. We breathe very casually, as a result of which many toxins which are accumulated in the body in the form of gaseous toxins, they remain accumulated, get saturated in the bloodstream. Because we keep on eating, eating, eating. And part of the food is digested and assimilated and used for building tissues, giving energy to the body. The remaining part of the undigested, unwanted food is thrown out of the body in three forms: solids, liquids and gases. Solids are thrown through the fecal material, the liquids are thrown through the urination, and the gaseous toxins — I am not telling the gas emissions, no — gaseous toxins are accumulated in the bloodstream. And those toxins become so saturated in our bloodstream that when there is no more possibility of absorbing the toxins, they get deposited in the joints, all the joints. Because joints are the places where there is emptiness. So this bone, other bone, and in between there is a space. So there these toxins get accumulated. And because they are toxins, they start eating the heads of the bone. They start destroying the cartilaginous disc if it is there. And they also start dehydrating the synovial fluid, which is required for the mobility of every joint. Because of these toxins, these joints start getting affected. See, when we break our joints, nothing is broken. Now, what is that sound coming? The sound is the gases which are accumulated here, they are let loose. Again, they go back to the bloodstream. Now, third point. None of us want unwanted thoughts. Yet the thoughts come. So normally we complain. Don't complain. Find out why. Now, like all of you are sitting, imagine below you there is a small little stone or something very small, insignificant. When you sit on that, initially that sharpness will be absorbed by your biological cushion. After some time, that sharpness will start hurting you. And when it starts hurting, every now and then we'll do like this. But it is still there. See? In the same manner, these toxins which are saturated in our bloodstream, they are responsible for acting as a stimulus for the mind to throw thoughts in the form of disturbances. Like if somebody has constipation, that constipation is reflected on his face. In the same manner, this gaseous constipation is reflected in our mind in the form of a disturbed mind. So like we have to go twice, thrice to the toilet in a day to remove the unwanted stuff from the body, exactly the same way we have to practice pranayama twice, thrice a day. And the purpose is purification of the blood. This is not mentioned in Patanjali's Yoga Darshan. This is mentioned in Yajnavalkya Smriti and Vasishtha Samhita. It's called there as the Nadi Shodhanam, the purification of the blood. And when this is being done regularly, then slowly the blood is no more carrying unwanted gaseous toxins, which are the byproduct of the food, metabolism, etc. Then the mind remains relatively quiet. Now the third step, fourth step. We breathe normally 15 times per minute. When these joggers go for running, their breathing increases. But because of their breathing increase, they are not getting separated from the body identification. They get more identified with the body. So they want to show to the world the perspiration that they have, the body that they have. See? Because too much body oriented. Spiritual practice is not body oriented. So when we do this pranayama, the pranayama is done in such a manner that we are able to squeeze out the toxins from the blood, and therefore we take deep breathing. Breathe in deep as much as one can, and then slowly breathe out fully, squeezing the lungs. And when this is done for 10 minutes or 15 minutes, then all the toxins which were accumulated in the body, they are thrown out. And when this is done, the oxygen requirement of the body is reduced to a great extent because you are sitting quiet. And because the oxygen requirement is reduced to the minimum, the breathing frequency also drops. And the breathing frequency goes very less from 15 per minute to maybe 3, 4 per minute. Very slow. And after some time, then when you stop effortful pranayama, then the quality of your breathing will be slow and shallow. This slow and shallow breathing quality is a master key which will keep the body and the mind separated. Oh, next point. Separation of the body and the mind means mind has got two functions. One, the expression of mind in the body is life. Second, the mind takes the shape and the form of the body. This second aspect of the mind, because of which the mind has taken a particular shape and a form, that forms a personality, I versus you. Life doesn't form a personality. So when this pranayama is practiced properly, this mind starts giving up the shape and the form of the body. And thus, the individual mind disappears and the total mind alone remains. To understand this, take an example. Different ornaments. All ornaments have a common factor called as gold, but their personalities are established on account of the name, form, and the utility. In the same manner, mind as a common denominator is expression of life. But life is not enough. Then the next step takes place, that the mind form the shape and the form of the body, and individuality is born. And when individuality is born, then I versus you starts happening. And be attentive. And then the thinking processes in relation to that particular body. It is something like this. Suppose I take this object in my hand. Now my hand has the influence of the hold on this object. If I don't remove this object, I may forget. But I have to write something. We do this thing on airports. So we put the pen in between our two fingers, and without leaving the mobile phone anywhere, we start writing. Our original handwriting is influenced by our hold on the mobile phone, is it not? Exactly the same way, when the mind is holding on to a particular body's shape, form, the mind will start thinking in relation to that body. Thinking in relation to a particular body is called as individuality or the personality. And this happens with everything and every being. When I went for a walk in the morning, the sheep were everywhere. Now I am walking, I have nothing against the sheep. But the sheep will start thinking, oh, that fellow is coming. I think he may kill us. He may beat us. So started shouting. And then some of the in front, some backside. And there was a chaos. And I was walking slowly. I had nothing to do. So those who are on the backside, they thought, we should go back and, you know, join with the group. So they came running. When they came running, I got afraid. I got, they are going to beat me or what? See? Because they have the personality, I have the personality. Till such time, the sense of otherness is valid, this samsara will continue. The day, the moment, the sense of otherness disappears. There is no I versus you. See, friends. And this can be achieved only when we attain freedom from body identification. See? Like when our teeth bite our own tongue, there is no ill feeling towards the teeth. Or when the tongue goes and digs the food in between the teeth, there is no thank you, darling. Because there may be differences, but there is no differentiation on account of the differences. This is the ultimate a yogi should attain. Bhagavad Gita says, Atma upammena sarvatra samam pashyati yorjuna sukham va yadi va dukham sa yogi paramo mataha. He is a param yogi, he is a supreme deluxe yogi. Who? He who is able to join the happiness of others happily, not jealousy, I know. And he who is able to extend a helping hand to the needy without any efforts by default, he is the real yogi. See, friends. Therefore, one must be very clear about this. Don't be satisfied only if you can sit for some time, half an hour, 1 hour, it is not a great thing. If you are able to stand in the hot sun for hours together, it's not a great thing. Tree stand. See, we have to discover this one common denominator, which alone is expressing through the variety. And once we discover that, then there is fulfillment in life. See, friends, it is for this purpose pranayama is practice. Now, if this is clear, then you are all expert in pranayama. So, I don't have to tell you anything. Yet, we can practice for some time and experience. What is the experience like to be other than the body? This is what our goal is. Now, the way you want to sit, sit down except in Shavasana. This is my observation. I don't know how it happens, why it happens. None of the yoga students throughout the world I move, they can sit in one posture properly. Keep on moving here and there, and then sitting for listening to the lecture with a bhujangasana. This is not a way to sit in the classroom. Discipline is not only we should do this thing 4 o'clock, this is 5 o'clock, this thing. This is a dumb discipline. The real discipline is when we are doing something, it should be done in a proper manner. See? You can imagine the teacher is teaching, somebody is lying down here, somebody is there, somebody is there. As if it is a graveyard and the teacher is waiting, when is my turn? So sit properly. Take minimum support in life. Lesser the support you have, more happy you are. See? If you can, do not take the support of the back. If you are sitting in the chair or near the wall. If you want to take, you do whatever you like. Now we begin. We are clear about the goal. Freedom from body identification. So we begin with a cheerful, happy mood. We are here by our own choice. Nobody has compelled us. We are not obliging anyone in this world. It is our need that we have come. Second point, in our heart is our beloved Lord and the Guru Maharaj. The Lord protects us from within, Guru guides us from within. Third, we have to drop our total past. Therefore, we take the position of Mr. Nobody. Because somebody is nothing but the coolie carrying the load of the total past. Fourth, adjustment. We don't plan what we will do after a meditation. So the future is blocked. Now we are in the utter present. Now if you observe your own body posture, you will see that the base is firm, vertically the body is steady, now we take to the next step, be aware that the breathing is happening. Do not concentrate. Concentration is done by standing on the platform of mind. There is no self-concentration. There is self-awareness. Like our own presence, we don't concentrate. We are merely aware of the presence that we are. Now what happens by this be attentive to understand, then you will get the benefit. We do not do breathing. Breathing happens. Number two, we always breathe in the present. Number three, when we are just aware of this breathing, the doer of pranayam is not born. So we are not doing pranayam. Not a single breathing should be missed. Initially, we were aware of breathing. Now, just we remain aware and remain indifferent towards breathing. You can experience the change that happens from awareness of breathing to indifference towards breathing. Now the body is no more an issue for us. Now the body has completely disappeared from the mind. And therefore, there is no concept of inside or outside. Now we are homogeneous, undivided conscious being. If there is any pressure inside the body on any point, means we are yet to disidentify from the body. Under such experience, start laying as to what must be the experience of space . The space is our nature. So all the shape and the form of body will disappear, and the pressures which were developed in the body will dissolve. And the experience is infinite expanse of just being. Take little deep breath. As you start increasing the depth of your breathing, the shape and the form of the body become crystallized. When you move your toes and fingers, the notion that I am inside the body and the world is outside the body becomes real. This experience that we had was not at the level of the mind. Therefore, you will not be able to repeat it. Don't make a memory of it. Offer everything at the feet of the Lord. Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnahat Purnamudachate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.